Today we will discuss Born's statistical interpretation of the wave function. Before going into the statistical interpretation of the wave function, I would like to preview a little bit of the previous lecture and also discuss the foundation of quantum mechanics. So, I hope you remember the last time that physicists or the scientists, they were about to wind up the physics, that it has now been completed and the rest of the people which will be coming will have nothing for research, but they will just do the things with more and more accuracy. And then they came to interact with the black body radiations. And you know what happened in the black body radiation? The black body name was tossed up by Kirchhoff, Gustav Kirchhoff, in 1860. And it was not explainable by the physics of that time. What was the problem? That if we take the wavelength on this axis and the intensity on this axis and we heat a body, then it has a spectrum like this. If we heat it more, its spectrum increases and there is a shift and like this. So this is the one way you heat plot, this is another heat value, this is another, and this is another. The existing physics was not able to explain this spectrum, that why when we heat a body, different wavelengths are emitted. And if those different wavelengths are emitted, means they are electromagnetic waves, then how an equation can fit this thing? At that time there was no equation which can fit this spectrum. And the person who came to explain this thing was Max Planck. And he actually explained this by considering the energy in the form of packets. And he called those packets as quanta. And from there the name came in of quantum. Quantums a singular and quanta a plural. H was called as the Planck's constant. And this was the smallest value in physics. And so far this is the smallest value in physics. 34 joule second. So Planck actually introduced his constant and he said that the energy is not a continuous thing, it is in the form of packets and those packets are quanta. And the singular of it is quantum. It was not the first time that someone has tossed up the issue of the particle nature of light. Before him, Newton has done the same thing and he has given the name corpuscular to this thing. Then, and he explained the spectrum very well. And after him, another problem in the 1920s came in, and that was the issue of photoelectric effect. The photoelectric phenomenon was not explainable by the common physics at that time, and the issue of the energy and intensity was there, because energy, some threshold energy was required, some threshold frequency was required for the emission of the electrons from the metal surface by UV light. While there was no restriction like from the metal surface, if I'm having one bulb and it is having a certain energy and it is not able to eject the electron out of the metal surface, then if I bring even hundreds of bulbs, the same bulbs, they are not able to emit electrons from the surface. Because increasing the number of bulbs is actually increasing the intensity and not the energy of the bulb. So this was an issue, and this was resolved by Einstein by the same thing, that E is equal to h nu is equal to hc over lambda, and he gave the concept of the threshold energy or threshold frequency, and he resolved the issue and called those quanta, the energy, those quanta he called is photons. And he wrote that actually one photon will interact with one electron. One photon with one electron. So this resolved the issue of intensity, because you know one photon with one electron, now it's a matter of energy. And many photons with one electron, it's now the issue of intensity. Because if you increase the number of photons, you are increasing the intensity. If you increase the energy of one photon, then it is actually the energy. So Einstein said that one photon will interact with one electron, not two photons with one electron, or more than two photons. So he solved the photoelectric issue by this statement, right? And this is addressing the issue of energy, not the issue of intensity. And he explained the photoelectric effect. Both of Max Planck and Einstein, Albert Einstein, they were awarded Nobel Prizes for their achievements or for their explanation. So this is also the particle nature of light, not a wave nature of light. And then one question came in that what about that we say that light was earlier considered as a wave and then it was considered as a particle. Then this was another, you can say, breakthrough in the history of physics or science, that a question came in that can particle behave like wave? Is wave theory was there, and that wave was then replaced by the particle nature. Here particle nature. Is it possible for the particles to have a wave nature? Then this thing was addressed by Louis de Broglie, and de Broglie actually said that yes, this is possible, that the wave property can be associated with particles. Lambda, the momentum, we can write it this way, that it is h over lambda. Then the momentum of a particle will be actually equal to this as well. Earlier, the momentum was, for a wave, it was p equal h bar k, where k is the wave number, which is 2 pi over lambda. And then p is actually mv, means this is the particle nature, and then this particle is having associated one wave, and this wave is called the matter wave, particle waves. like we are having water waves, we are having sound waves, we are having electromagnetic waves, and now we got particle waves as well, right? These are certain type of particles which we call quantum mechanical particles. Those particles behave like a wave as well. And this was the breakthrough that de Broglie connected. Means they connected wave to particle, wave to the discrete nature, and this discrete nature or particle nature was connected back to wave by Louis de Broglie. Right? So we are now having the two situations. And the two situations, when we clarified those one, then now we will turn to quantum mechanics, because we said something that this nature will be due to the quantum mechanical's particle only, not the classical particle. So we will discuss that, what is the classical physics regime and what is the quantum physics regime. So we will discuss this thing now, and so we will have to establish some classical mechanics principles and some quantum mechanics principles. You know about the classical bit. In classical mechanics, what we do in classical mechanics, you know that we are having the equation of motion. And what is the equation of motion? F equal ma, that's the equation of motion. Let's say, for example, we are having a body and that body is moving along the x-axis, for example, and this body is having certain set of, you can say, the state of motion of this body, because it will be under a certain force which will be the function of x and t, and it will cause this body to move. And we have this is F equals ma, and this a we write m d square x over d t square. And from here we have the motion of this body as a function of time. When you have this one, x of t, this is called the state of motion of this body. Because when you are having x of t equal to 0, what do you say? The body is in rest. When you say x of t is non-zero, it means the body is changing position. When you derivate this x with respect to t, you get the velocity of the body. When you derivate that velocity of a body, then you get acceleration in the body, and so on. Once you know this state of motion, then you can calculate the other parameters, right? So this is called the state of the body. Now, this is a classical particle, and everything is very deterministic. When we will have quantum mechanical particle, can we do like this? Because this is the equation of motion, F equal ma. What kind of equation we will be required for the quantum mechanical particles? Because quantum mechanical particles are not behaving like classical particles, and this we will come to know, that I can write that f of x, for example, the x component, this will be m ax. I can write not as a vectorial form but in a component form, and I can write this thing is f x equals m d squared x over d t squared. Now I know about f as well. What is f? F is always, you can say, the negative gradient of potential. This is so the potential, the negative derivative of the potential is called, means this is the space derivative. Now here you are having the time derivative. So minus curly V by curly X, this is your potential energy. If you derivate this thing with respect to X, you will get force. So this is the equation, and then there will be some initial conditions, some boundary conditions, and those conditions will actually give you the exact solution of this equation. Because you know there are always boundary or limiting conditions to a certain equation in order to make it deterministic, in order to make it determined. This is the way in classical physics. Now what about the quantum mechanics? In quantum mechanics, instead of x of t, we write the state of a particle.